Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming. I call this meeting of the Sherrilyn ISD to order. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present. At this meeting and has been duly called, and the notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Opens Meeting Act, Texas Government Code, Chapter 551. Board members present today forming the quorum are Mr. David Keith, Mr. Pepe Garcia, Mr. Ricky Longoria, Mr. Alejandro Rodriguez, Ms. Marita Ramirez, and myself, Hector Rivera. We will now proceed with the invocation that will be led by Mr. Pepe Garcia. If you please stand.
Pray your own way. Almighty God, we come together for the good of the children in our schools. Give us your wisdom as we make decisions that will affect them today and in the years to come. Help us to work well together, recognizing that each of us, students, parents, educators, and community members are here because we love children and we want what is best for them. We ask for your blessing and your guidance. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. We will now proceed to the Pledge of Allegiance.
Mr. Pepe Garcia.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We don't have the other one, so we just want to proceed.
Texas pledge.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
That'll bring us to agenda item 5, public comments.
No public comments.
There are no public comments today. Bring us straight to item 6, business. Item 6A, discussion and consideration to approve a resolution regarding approval of administrative efforts to withdraw from South Texas ISD to avoid duplication of taxation.
Mr. President, members of the board, Sherrilyn ISD is a current member of the South Texas Association of School Organization. South Texas Association is an advocacy group made up of districts in the South Texas area, precisely mainly Region 1 and Region 2. Sherrilyn ISD, by passing this resolution, is supporting legislative efforts to change how South Texas ISD is funded. South Texas ISD was originally created to serve special populations. Since then, it has now evolved into having some comprehensive schools that now also offer UIL events in academics and in athletics. We are seeking for the state to reevaluate their funding formula.
Thank you, Dr. Vidotti. Do I have a motion on the floor?
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Pepe Garcia, a second by Ramiro Rodriguez. Is there any further discussion or questions regarding this topic?
I just have one question, and I don't know if they're related or not. And there was a time when we had, at South Texas, I'm sorry, Sherrilyn ISD kids of the South Texas ISD that were participating in athletic events, one has nothing to do with the other, right? Is that sound familiar to you, Pam? You're kind of shaking. There was a time I remember, I think we had a volleyball player that was South Texas ISD, but come over here and play with us. And so this would not affect any, if we have kids like that.
Go ahead, down. Because that was recent.
That, yeah, you are correct. At a certain point, those students, since they did not offer those athletic programs, could go back to their home school attendance zone.
Okay.
At the discretion of the ISD. We would allow them. Now, they started an intramurals program. They started, they might have had, like within the STISB, their own competitions. And at that point, they made the decision to go that route, because I think parents were kind of, hey, we want our kids to compete. When they made that decision, that was off the table.
Okay. I'm not even sure one's even related to the other, but I didn't know whether the kids would.
You can't be enrolled in one school and represent another unless they do not offer those particular programs. But once they just made that decision, I think at that point the superintendent was kind of, well, that's, you need to ask them. But it was on them. Once they made that decision, they were. I remember it was in the middle of volleyball season. We had
Yeah, that's familiar.
Yes.
A student. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Coach. Mm-hmm.
So it's the TAPS. Is it there?
They probably are. It might be.
So we have to read it. Do we have to read the resolution or not?
I don't think you can. If you want it in the record, you can.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right, I'll seek a motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Motion passes 6-0. Business item 6B, discussion and consideration to approve capital improvement projects. Mr. O'Thayer.
Thank you, President Rivera, Dr. Vialli, members of the board. This is a presentation for capital projects, but But before we get there, I do want to do a couple of recaps. I wanted to recap our security expenditures. I wanted to recap our ESSER 2 and ESSER 3 expenditures. Also what we call the emergency unbudgeted expenditures, an update there. And then also, and then lead into the capital projects again. And then finally, go over the fund balance and the impact of these items. So I wanted to touch on these because, again, at the end of the day, when we look at the capital projects, I think all this will play into what the board decides to do. So going into the security expenditures recap, you saw this slide in October when we presented it. Back in October, when we came to you, we showed you what projects we were going to take, and then we gave you an estimated amount at that time. We were looking at certain projects. We didn't know the exact number. We hadn't talked to vendors in some cases. But now that we have, now that everything's been pretty much finalized, I wanted to come back and just show you the revised number of what we're looking at when it comes to the expenditures. For the most part, the slide is very similar to the one in October. We did add two projects, the very two at the end. The vapor detectors came out during that October meeting, and so we went ahead. That project has been completed. That's why when you see the estimated amount there, you see zero, because at that time, you know, it wasn't under. We decided that that would be a project we want to, so now that's why you see a number now as a revised number. And then the last one, the elementary gates and guard checks. Again, that one just came up during the December board meeting. So the board did ask us to go and come up with a number or see what it would cost to put elementary gates and security guard checks up front. So going back to the slide, the difference between what we have, what we presented in October and what you see now is revised, pretty much is just the elementary gate guard checks and then also the vapor detectors that we have added. We've covered these in the past. I mean, I don't know if there's any questions. As far as the elementary gates and security guard checks, Mark has a little bit more detail. We have some pictures there that we want to show you. And I believe that's what the board requested in December. So, Dave, you want to show the slides?
The pictures?
Yes,
pictures.
Sure.
So we had talked about fencing. What we are looking at right now is 6 feet ornamental fencing. We measured
the fence specifically, or is this okay?
Well, we can do both. We went through, took linear measurements of all the campuses, all the elementary campuses. We didn't put a slide on all of them, but we got a few of them so you could see. Total linear footage that we're looking at is 7,200 linear feet of fencing to cover all 8 elementary campuses, and it's our parking lots. Some are bigger based on the parking lots, some are smaller. But these are just ideas of what the fencing, where it would go. We would tie into the existing fencing and building that we have already. So one of the big questions that we have is you would have one parking area for teachers, one parking area for staff, one for staff and one for public, where you have the public. We think that that's where we would put the guard shack. So as they come in, and then we would have an automatic gate as an entrance. I'm sorry, as an exit. So as they come up, they drive up, it lets them out. Now the question that we did in your pricing, we put an automatic gate also where the teachers were at as well. So they would come in the morning, we'd lock the gates once school started, and then if they had to leave, then they could go out through there, and there would be an automatic gate. So in the pricing you see that having the gates on both parking lots with the campuses that have that. There's two campuses, I think we only have one entrance and one exit, which Jensen and John H. Sherry, the way that they're set up. So they wouldn't have that extra automatic gate, but they would all have the guard shack. They would come through there, they would get raptored in. Here's just an idea of what it would look like. This is approved fencing through the state with the new standards that they've come up with. That's what we went out and we priced it out.
So I wasn't able to attend the December meeting, but
Is this a result of the audit, the safety audits that were, is that kind of like a recommendation that they made?
Well, this was some of the recommendations that we had.
You already had.
At the town hall.
Oh, okay, yeah, right.
We had some of these, and so we had
said. But once we had the audit and we saw some things, we shared with the board, some opportunities.
Yes.
Okay.
You said it's only at 7,000 linear feet?
Yes, ma'am.
For all eight campuses?
For all eight campuses, only 200 linear feet.
Didn't we discuss an 8-foot fence mark, or was it an 8-foot recommended by the state?
So state is recommending an 8-foot chain, if you go chain link.
Okay.
Hurricane chain link type fencing. If you do ornamental fencing, they're okay with 6 feet. Their thought is it's hard to climb those.
Yes.
Right, so that's why we decided, well, and also, you know, aesthetically, we don't want the campuses to look like that.
I was expecting a chain link fence that looks a lot better, like.
And when you say it links up to the current fencing is also ornamental, or some of it chain link?
Some of it is chain link.
Right, so it's gonna, are you going to replace the chain link so it's uniform, or it's just all gonna be?
It's just probably, I mean, the way we looked at it, of course, right, it's just to hook up to where it is right,
right
now.
Okay.
Because a lot of it's kind of in the back, so, because to change that, then you're probably gonna have to
right.
go back and look at like,
the
whole
right.
campus. And, mm-hmm. So our thought was we'd just put the front.
Yeah, 7,000 just doesn't sound like a lot to me for eight campuses. You're looking
yeah.
at, you know, 800 and whatever feet per campus. It just didn't sound like a lot, but it's because some of them already have.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. And this is just the front parking lots. It's just the front of the parking lot. It's not the whole campus. I don't even have those measurements
yeah.
of the whole campus.
Jensen there has a little fence.
Right in the front.
And then,
right in the front, right.
Yeah.
So we would take
yeah.
down the little fence, and the Jensen would just be that whole front area.
Got it.
That's it, yes.
You can feel the benefits when you attend or go to Sherry North Junior High, you can tell how well that is controlled all access.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So
we would do that.
So if I may, Mark, on the areas that we don't have, then here we are going to have to make those where we're going to have to change out on these hurricane, right, to where they're not able to climb.
Yes, at some, yes, we're going to have to come back. We're so kind of, I know TEA is still going back and forth on that, and I know Pam and I, we've been seeing that through the safety audits that we've had to do through Texas State and all that. They're still kind of going back because there is a lot of pushback from districts statewide that says, we built most, if you go, most campuses are 6 feet high.
Yeah.
Now who's going to pay for the extra 2 feet or what they recommended? You put netting, you put these plastic slits, and everyone's like, great ideas, but there's a cost to it.
Yeah.
And so that's where I know that there's still pushback going. So
yeah, because the recommendation is if you have access between the breezeway and so forth, then that's where you put that 8-foot fence.
Right.
And then for the rest, it's only that 6 feet fence that's allowed, and you're being compliant. So, good point.
Mark, two questions. The placement of the fences, and go back to the drawing, the way I think that was Shimatsu maybe, that you had, the aerial view. Whatever that one is, but for example, and we're all just trying to be efficient with the amount of fencing. For example, you know, you did go along the border, you left all that open space, and it looks like we're giving all that up, right?
Yes, yes, sir.
And I just wonder, you know,
could we do
it didn't, to Marisa's point, it didn't seem like a whole lot of fencing, but is it any more aesthetically pleasing if you just follow the curvature of the street and don't allow somebody a running start to the fence, right?
We could definitely.
So that's one confidence. Yeah. The second one is when you have, and I think this is the way to do it in Pioneer, where we have a guard shack in front and we have an automatic gate in the back. But I'm assuming in most cases you don't want parents going out the automatic gate because you don't know if they have a child, you don't have that somebody else's child. And so that automatic gate is just, it's there to be used, but not necessarily the normal day, because I don't think you'd want that parent to come in and out from the same point, no?
In the elementaries, that would be difficult because the roadways, I'd have to go back and look. Some of them, you may have, but as you know, the thought was, since we've checked them in, we know they've come in, they checked in, they're going to go to the front office to check in as well. When they left, they would just go out that way. It would just try to be the flow of traffic.
Well, again, I just thought, in high school, that's not the way we do it, right? You think you'd have the same level of trust, and we... The last time I went through, you don't necessarily go out the back gate. You clear the guard shack, and you know, he looks at you, hey, you can have a child in your car or not, right? And you're not going to have that on the way out.
Pioneer, I think the difference is they have Diamondback Drive, so you don't have a main thoroughfare where you're, I think that's the traffic.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, the parking lots are one way. Like at Johnny Cherry, you've got to go in one way. You can't
go
back out
exactly.
that way. Yeah, because there's only enough for that. Yeah.
This is...
Yeah, no, 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 I realize this is just what you threw on the page.
We can change that, but again, I guess my one thing was trying to get, but yes, sir, our thought was, you come in, right, we checked you in, we've done all that, this is an elementary campus, they're going to go in, they're going to get their kids, whatever, and then when they're done with their business, they can go out, because they've already been raptored, they've already gone through a security checkpoint, because right now, in all honesty, they just come in, we don't have anything until they get to the front door, they get raptored, and they leave. This, we would say, we would put the extra security there. And then the gate will only open from the inside.
No, you drive up to the...
But I do agree, Mark, that we need to encompass the perimeter.
Okay, we can
do that. That way we could, you know, have access to that space that we needed from the inside.
And to be honest, I'll double check. I just know that we try to do some graphic illustrations, and so it's some of us that aren't the best graphically, but I will double check to make sure. And it may be the curvature, it's just that when we put it together, it's kind of
presentation.
Straight lines are a lot easier than some of that curvature and stuff. So yes, but we'll make sure that we definitely do that. We'll double check.
So no VR headset to allow us
to do that. So most of the campuses, with the exception of John H. Cherry and Jensen, have the two parking lots. So they'll have the, you know, both areas, everything gated, and the two exits during the school hours. And then you can program, they can open up at a certain time, and so during pick up, drop off, we can have them open, and then when we're done with drop off or with pick up, we close. So now we're in our secure posture.
I've got one more question,
yes,
just out of curiosity. Do you have the, like, what is the estimated price per linear foot on ornamental versus 8 foot versus 6 foot?
No, I just got ornamental pricing.
Okay. And what's the linear foot on that? Just out of curiosity.
I don't have that. I've got it at my desk.
Okay.
Because we were buying them in 6 foot sections.
They come in 6 foot sections. Okay.
They come in 6 foot sections already. But I will get you that price on that. I didn't go with the fencing, with the 8 foot or 6 foot hurricane type fencing, just because I think aesthetically,
Would
look a lot better. But we can go back and get that price.
Well, and it's awfully expensive right now too. That's why I'm just curious of the ornamental versus the hurricane, because the hurricane is off the charts expensive.
Yes, do you know that one?
$40
a linear foot,
yeah.
with the
chamber,
with the chamber.
Ornamental.
Ornamental is at 40, more or less.
More or less.
Sounds about right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we can. I'll work on getting those details.
Okay. Just wondering.
Want to go back to the slide, David?
Thank you, David.
Thank you, David. So again, we do have an estimated cost there of $750,000. All these costs that you see here, they're a one-time cost, right? The two items here that have not been approved yet is the bus turnaround and then, of course, the elementary gates. Other than that, every other project has already been, it's on its way to get completed. So we've ordered the products. POs have been issued out. Everything's ready to go. So, on the next slide, the only thing I wanted to show on the next slide.
I'm sorry, real quick. The bus turnaround is for John H. Cherry, right?
No, bus turnaround is for here.
Oh, for here.
For the high school behind the 200 building behind the State 3.
That was being done at the request of the city or the engineers? Or?
No, that was being done at our request because it's pretty banged up. So we got it going. We were able to do some temporary work on it, but we do need to change it out because the idea would be to, once we get, right, we now have all the guard shacks, we could bring in traffic from SA3, keep them back, try not to have parents go all the way from up front, all the way to the back driving to go to SA3. We manage SA3, keep them in their area, high school over here, for safety.
And I remember you did give me an explanation, Mark, as to why the price doubled on that one from the beginning estimate.
So when we first did it, we contacted some contractors and said, hey, you know, we figured, okay, we're thinking right around $50,000. Well, when we contacted contractors to come and give us pricing, we were way off. And so at that point, we exceeded our $25,000, I think, threshold. So now I've got to bring in an engineer because I just can't. It's considered construction, and because over $25,000, we have to bring in the engineer to make sure it's done properly, because we could affect drainage, things like that. So
now it's not an overlay; it's a complete rip out. And
we're gonna rip out that whole corner, yes, sir. And then we're gonna concrete it. We want to go with concrete because the buses on the turns.
That explains the cost, yes, right there. It's concrete, not asphalt.
It's not gonna be asphalt. It's gonna be that turnaround, the U part of it, is gonna be concrete. Because the buses are coming in, and when they're turning, the asphalt, especially here, we're hot 9 months out of the year, it eats it up too quick.
So one thing that I know from personal experience is if you're on your way to go to the high school, Sherryland High School, going through Taylor Road and entering the back entrance in the morning alleviates having to wait in a giant line. Mm-hmm. Will that no longer?
No, that in the morning's pickup drop off, that's not going to change anything. But as once we get, I like to call our security posture, school starts, we lock gates and everything. Now I can have a parent who has to go to SAT, we can bring them in through the back, and if they need to go out, they can turn around through there and all that. We will recommend, hey, you have now this nice drive, drop off your kid back there. Try not to get all the traffic everywhere. It just helps us know who's on campus, is what the thought is. But yes, we would still have all those open.
All right, thank you guys.
Yes, sir. So as I mentioned, that $2.6 million a one-time cost. The next slide just shows if we do this, again, we're going to have to incur the cost of 8 guards at the elementary. And if you recall this slide from October, that current cost would be $186,000 to add that extra guard to man the security guard check. So just keep that in mind. That will be a recurring cost every year. Any other questions on security?
Okay. Is that an arm guard? You have 2 arm guards?
Yes, sir. Yes.
1 arm per contestant.
The replacing of guards with police officers, that's a doable thing? I mean, based on what with the conversations we had before, with difficult communication and finding personnel.
Is it a doable thing? I think if we give the police department enough time and all that, that we did do this presentation, it's something that we could do. If that's something that the board wanted to go, I would say we at this point, you'd probably have to get it ready for next school year. Because we looked at the county, with the constable's office, and we looked with PD, and we just need to give them a notice so they can go and hire the guards or the police officers that they would put on the campus. But it is something that we have looked at, and we did bring this presentation out before.
So just recapping the ESSER projects. ESSER 2, this was said already done, but just wanted to recap it. We had budgeted a little over $3.2 million. There was 3 projects here, Bill Gray North Junior High Childers, and then Warnke Elementary, the whole HVAC project. All those projects have been bidded out. They're ready. All we're waiting for is the units to come in for installation. We did come under budget there, $215,579, right? And so the price that you see there is the contract bid plus the 6.25 engineering fee.
Plus engineering fee.
Engineering fee. So that was all said and done.
Go to the next page.
So ESSER 3, again, we budgeted $7.3 million for the total budget. There was 2 main projects here, Chamato Elementary and the Sherryland High School. So again, what you're seeing here is everything has been bidded out with engineering fees. As you can see there, when you look at the balance, we went slightly went over the budget at $161,000. We were able to cover that through some other savings within ESSER 3 funding. But David, you go to the next page. But if you recall, the big thing in October was we came to you because there were still a couple of buildings that were pending. And at that time, our best estimate at that time, we had told the board we were going to be short about $2.5 million, right? So we went out to bid, and these last 3 buildings, the cafeteria, the gym, and SA3, we got the bids in. If you added the engineering costs, it's going to be $5.5 million. So we did get these bids in December. One thing that we talked about with Dr. Vidal, we didn't want to place them on the agenda because, again, we hadn't had time to discuss this with the board. On the good side is that these bids are valid for 60 days. So we can still, take our action and decide what we're going to do, and we can still put them on the agenda for this month if we wanted to, and we can take action on this. our recommendations are is going to be here is to reject these bids. And I'll have Mark discuss why, but you want to go ahead?
So on these buildings, they're working good. One of the things that we saw is we just have a lot of old equipment in there. So when we first started this, these were numbers that we pulled out from when the bond. So these numbers are 5-6 years old when we first started the bond. And so when the architect put these numbers right, we hadn't done the true engineering. When we got in there, there's a lot of old equipment, there's equipment that's got to get replaced that we weren't sure. In the gym, one of the big things that we found is we knew the heaters weren't working. We didn't realize until we got in there, they're gas heaters. We don't have gas heaters anymore. So now you've got to rip out all that equipment and put in electrical equipment. So that's why you're seeing, why the costs are so much. The good thing is we can cool all these buildings. We have no problem cooling them right now. The gym, we did put some money in. So we feel comfortable saying there's a couple of units at like the cafeteria, some rooftop, a 25-ton rooftop unit that we need to change out. The air handlers and that internal equipment is still functioning, but we do know at some time we have to replace it. So we can replace the air handlers, still cool the buildings right now, wait for the next year or two, because anything we order now, it's 2024 before it comes in. We can wait to see if prices settle, if things settle. We're hearing that some manufacturers are saying, okay, by 2023, summertime late summertime early fall, that they might be catching up with their orders and with equipment orders. And so we can wait. We feel the units get what gotten with the technicians. They feel the units are good. We do have certain hot areas. We can put some money aside as an emergency fund as well. If we have anything else, that we can change those units out. The main problem ones we have taken care of at this time. But these are the ones. So we feel that if we need to, because we know that other projects have come up, right? The security, other things that the board wants, we can wait on this. As Hannah said, we're not as pressed because we don't have ESSER funding, that we have to meet timelines. We've already taken care of that. So this is something that if the board says, well, we can wait. I do still need some money to get some of these units replaced. And then so when we do the engineering, then those units are going to take care of. We don't have to replace those units. So it's not like we would spend money and then rip the equipment out. No, it would just be less of the equipment that we would have to replace if we decided to do it again.
Question I received a couple of times was about controlling the temperature of the gyms at the facility. Is that going to be a possibility?
Yes, we are working controls.
Okay.
Yes, it's the controls. The controls we have are old and antiquated, so we would get those taken care of. And the good thing is when we put the controls in, whatever equipment you have, you just put through the controls. So yes, the controls would be one of those things that we would have to take care of. We would ask for some funding to take care of those things.
Hey, Mark, a couple of related questions, I guess. I'm going to use the second one as an example. The budget of 890, and then I guess it came back at 2.4, right? That 890, where do we get that number? Is that the engineer went through there and said,
no,
this is what you can expect,
no,
or how is that happening?
So when we first did this, Mr. Longoria, when ESSER first came out, right, we had to apply, we had to get approved for the funding, for the project. So what we did is we went back to what we had presented on our bond. So then we went through and we just extrapolated what the pricing was per square foot for the AC. And so that's where we came out with these numbers, because we hadn't had the engineers go through. They didn't give us enough time to go through, so we had to come up with budgets. We did, review them with the engineers, and they said, they did feel comfortable. One of the biggest changes that has happened because of COVID, because of ESSER, is we've gone from AC has gone from $4,000 a ton to over $9,600 a ton. The price for AC. So with the whole COVID, with the supply chain, with everything that's out there, costs just shot up a lot more than we had anticipated. We had $10 million, we got that in. I know right now costs, and you won't, they're probably even higher, but we're looking 70-80%, right? The cost per ton has more than doubled.
Yeah. I mean, I can totally get, if we got the 890 from the bond, it was just somebody's best guesstimate,
yes,
right? So I get that part. I mean, in terms of like
the cost of AC, I mean, I still got clients putting in AC, right? And they're not getting surprised anymore. You know, because in a matter of 90 days of bidding, it's not going to double or triple. That's not what I've seen. But nonetheless, I was just curious how we're missing it by that much. And I get it. If that's the historical number you use, I guess my other related question is, you talk about like the heat within the gym. I know we've done AC projects in the past in the gym, right?
Right.
Okay. So it would seem to me by now, because that gym's decades old,
right?
Certainly there's an as-built set of plans out there that finding gas would not be a surprise, right? Because somebody should, it'd be documented somewhere by now, I think.
And we don't have plans for those. And that was a tricky part. We didn't have the as-built. Because what we've done is, Mr. Lundgren, in the past, we've installed a unit. We've taken a unit out, we put another unit in, right? Most of the stuff that we've done has been on condensing units, on a chiller that outside that feeds the equipment inside. It wasn't until we got into this that said, okay, if we're going to do this, we need to bring it up to standard, that they got in and they said, hey, you have gas heaters.
Okay, so we don't have the as-built, and that's just a
bummer. Now we do. Now we do because of all the engineering we've done. So we know what we have now, what we have today. So going forward, yes, we have the as-built, and we know what's there, and whenever we change it out, we will have them. But there was a few of the buildings, some of the older buildings here at the high school. We have a plan room, a record room, and we went through them, the engineers came and bought them, and we couldn't find it. That's where we got a few surprises about that.
The city has to have it. The city has to, the city should ideally, it's part of their permanent records, that they should have all of those. Anything that's a lifetime asset of like 25 years or whatever, the city's required to keep those permanently. So.
I was not aware of that. I will let you.
I'm a retention expert. No, but they
but now because of the work we've done with engineering, we have that information. We know what's where, so now we have that digitized, and we're going to make sure we digitize it so we don't have to worry about a paper copy anymore. We're going to have it digitized.
I can also do that for you.
I know, so you're going to pay for that.
So if
people don't get it for free. Yeah.
The engineer got it from the city and charged us.
Yeah, no, they're required by law. Now, the city can charge you per page, but the city by law is required to have those, and anybody can get it. They're public record.
There you go.
I guess just to reiterate the fact that if we don't, just to know the board that we will come to you, because these are old units, so it's really, we're band-aiding for a little bit and see where we land in a year or two, but
the need is not going to go away.
But now we'll know, like Richard was asking, we'll know more accurate as to that's why, I mean, we're so off right now, and maybe that's going to be the recommendation, but that now, at least now we know that we're going to be at that ballpark.
In that ballpark.
For sure. Yes.
Right. And then again, using general funds, we can take action anytime we want. Because exactly. Now it's general funds. So, yeah.
Exactly.
If you allow us that, we'll keep looking at it and see, okay, let's come back to the board with what we need.
Yes, sir. Good job.
Okay. But in any case, remember that number because it's going to come up. So.
It's a mental note. But in that ranking.
Mental note. Sorry, mental note. Okay. David, one more thing. Okay, so again, same slide that we presented in October, we call the emergency projects and unbudgeted items. It is, as you recall, during our budget presentation, I know I was asked, is there any capital projects in there? And we said no at that time, but of course we told the board we would take care of anything that comes up, right? And these are some of the things that have come up here. The biggest difference going again from what we estimated to what we have as a total now is two things that are driving that. When you look at the Sherland High School SA3 furniture, we estimated about $500,000. What we did now is we met with Ms. Garza. We actually have now the room counts, desk counts, everything for instructional purposes, and we've looked at recently purchased items. So that dollar amount also has increased about, you know, $350,000. It is highlighted in bold also because it's an item that's under that we haven't formally taken action. Everything else that's there, we've already taken care of, so that's a true number. And then the last project that you see on there, district computer room generator. So a little history on this one. This is a project that with Mr. Coberson, we have budgeted for. It was within our budget. The only difference is that we have budgeted at $200,000. We have now gotten a better or a truer number, and that's coming in at $400,000. So if we decided to proceed with that project, you know, it's $200,000 that I didn't budget for. And so a little history on that one, David, if you want to give a little history on why this project we need.
Quite honestly, is that the really bad freeze we had 2 years ago, 2021, the catastrophic freeze. We were very fortunate that our power did not fail here, but other districts around us, I mean, they lost, they had no generator, they had no power, their systems were down for the entire week. We were very fortunate. I mean, I live right here behind the high school. My power didn't fail either. I think we're on the same electric, but it doesn't mean that it won't happen if we do get a freeze like that again. So we really do need, we've been needing one for years now. And it's for our data center in the end. It's our server room. It's the heartbeat of the district. Our phone system, our wireless system, Skyward, everything runs out of that room. And that's what we're trying to do. We did tack on also for the surveillance side of things because we had a lockdown situation here one time and the power went out. We all kind of got a scare on that one because we've never been in a scenario where you're in a lockdown, a real lockdown, and then you lose power. This will also keep our surveillance camera systems and the Eagle Eyes room, so not just a data center, but a couple of the rooms over here, next door in our technology department. And they'll also stay online with power if we have a power failure. So, and the data center is via natural gas, not diesel. Right.
It's a natural gas with adding a little bit to it. And the other thing, I know David said the freeze, but we're more apt to get hit with a hurricane. And so we've had some glancing blows, but we've seen what damage with the storms now, and they come up. If we're out, you know, we lose power. Like David said, this is our heartbeat to the district. With the data center, we get the generator. We can still perform some vital functions to get everything back ready so we get school started as soon as possible. So I know he mentioned the freeze, but I also, on my end, I look at it, I'm more worried than the hurricane.
Yeah.
That's where we're more likely to get hit. And we've seen how storms have become more powerful for whatever reason may be. And so we just think that it's something that is vital to us. It's at 2. We have a power outage. They've got battery backup, but it only lasts for so long. We can keep the Eagle Eye up as well.
So as you say, natural gas, so whenever you decide that it's going to be the location, we do have those lines running with the...
Yes, that's part of the...
That's part of the construction,
okay.
Yes.
So we'll have permanent lines running, not those big tanks that they have...
No, we're going to have permanent underground lines. So as long as they're feeding natural gas, that generator will keep running.
So we have no generator right now?
Yeah.
We have battery backup.
Just battery about an hour.
Okay. About an hour?
Yeah.
And this allows for continued communication from the district to parents on what's going on.
Definitely. Yes. Yes.
And what about the data itself? Is there like redundancy outside of that room?
Many redundancies, yes, ma'am. We have air gap backups, we have off-site backups, and all the way to California.
Okay, so you do have them off-site, no problem.
Yes, yes.
So is it number 200 or 400?
It's 400.
Well, total. I do have 200 already in budget. So what you see there is a 200 that I don't have in budget. Yes, yes. So that's how we get to that $1.5 million in items that weren't budgeted for.
And that's also coming out of local?
Yes, sir. Fund balance, yes, sir. Okay. So keep that in mind. Okay. So capital improvement projects, right? So we have here two tables in there. The first table is, these are capital improvement projects that we would like for the board direction. These are capital projects that administration is coming to you for recommendation, right? Throughout you know, a couple of years, we've been hearing about some of these. We brought them up, we've discussed them. But I think now that we put ESSER aside for the most part, you know, we're ready to proceed and start addressing some of these capital improvement projects that we feel are needed. What you see on the right-hand side, the second table, is, of course, needs that we've talked about, right? Items that were in the bond. But when you start looking at those numbers, you know, realistically, those are projects that we would not be able to do through general fund. What you see on the left-hand side, those are typical projects that we could handle, we have done historically using general funds, using our fund balance. So that's how I broke it down into two different tables there. So again, these are up for discussion. We can answer any questions if you have any.
So the ones on the left-hand side are more important than the ones that you just showed us earlier? Is that what you're saying?
No, sir. They're pretty similar to what we've discussed in previous meetings, right? Those are items that we've had come up. I know, I think, the turf now is a little bit more urgent, you know, for once we, and Coach can talk a little bit about the turfs at Pioneer and the turf here at SHS. But these are all the same projects that, that have been in discussion, in several discussions, even going back to past, you know, previous year. But we just haven't, the only thing that's really changed is the dollar amount, right? So so we revise our dollar amounts, right? And so for instance, if you go back to Van Hall, David, if you can slide a little bit more, I know previously we talked about the Van Hall. I think initially during the bubble, we were thinking about 5.5 million.
Yeah,
but if we gave you, Ms. Ramirez, like I said, if we gave you a realistic number based on what we know now, that's $10 million. So even if we you wanted to do it, it's not something, like I said, like I was telling Dr. Vidal, it's not something that I think we could do it through fund balance. You know, that would require...
So starting there, all of these are realistic numbers.
Yes. Well, yes. Unless, like Mark said, unless once we get in there and the engineer or something else comes out, that we're going to account for. Yes, ma'am.
They're closer to that real number.
To the real number, yes. Yes. Yeah.
Let's go for 100 million.
How much?
100 million.
I can't the demolish of that building, Mark, $750,000 so you just knock it down and haul it away.
Price of diesel, all that has gone up, Ms. Lundgren, and again, this, you know.
Should have known that. How much we can just go do it, like,
and yes, and there could be abatement in there, too, that we have to, that we're accounting for. There could be some asbestos abatement.
Well, that's what makes it expensive. You know, that's the key.
Right. So
it could be even if the city just gives us the okay to knock it down, that cost should.
It could be, right? If we don't have any asbestos abatement, then yeah, you could definitely see that come down. But we have to take every scenario because of the age of that building, right? So we would, before we knock it down, we have to get some testing done. And we do have a program through TASB that they would come in and they would do the testing because there are some areas that in the ceiling that we're not sure about. So we would have to get that down, because where we have the false ceiling and then you have a higher ceiling that we would have to look at. But that could be, if we have to do abatement, yes, you know, we're definitely in that ballpark. And just depending how much abatement we would have to do, it could be next.
And so the only original part of that building is that white facade and the front.
It is my understanding that, yes, that's probably where you have that historical value.
That's where the resistance
value
is coming from the community, right, saying.
Yes, sir.
That it's a historical building, but it's only that facade.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Can it, that facade has to be knocked down as well?
Or,
I mean,
no,
can it be removed or moved somewhere, or can the bricks be kept?
We can do something. We talked about it at some point. If we ever did a new building, we could incorporate that into the new building. And we could, yes.
Just because sharing that, people love that whole thing,
yes,
right? So you can,
right,
there's some...
Right. Now, I don't know. Yes.
Sentimental, emotional value.
Yeah. Right. People went to Sherry Land, they're like, you can't knock that down, but if we can do something with it, then I feel like that satisfies, you know, what we have to do versus.
The stadium, right?
Yes. We could do that.
If
yes.
Once we were looking at that during bond time, and I'd have to go back with Rudy, our architect, but yeah. I think his thoughts were it would be almost impossible to save it.
Yeah, in its structure.
But he was going to replicate it.
Oh, got it.
That he could come really close the replication exactly like it is, as much as he could, but he was not sure that he could really save all this.
Well, even you take the bricks and you make a sidewalk, or you take the bricks and whatever.
Yes, and he was going to use some of those.
Yeah.
When he was giving a little plan, he was going to use some of those in the entrance of the building.
That's
so, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. No other questions. We'll proceed that way. We can come back, and I do want to cover a couple other things before we decide. So fund balance. I just want to give you an update. I know we completed our audit in December, so our fund balance did jump from 35.4 million to 40.9 million dollars. Right. So there was an increase there. Dave, you want to go to the next one? Okay. I did put here under the first indicator when it relates to fund balance for next year. So I ran the numbers already for next year. Of course, we would get our 10 points for first. And then again, the important number there is the second to the last number, fund balance required to meet the 75 days, right? Again, still at about $20 million, same as the year before, right? The one thing I do want to point out here, sir, is if you look at the, I think it's the fifth number there, thank you, David, right there. So what really determines that $20 million is how much money we spent. So last year, they're always going to go for the audit. They're going to look at how much did we spend in general fund, right? The number that we spent there was $96,781,000. We know that with everything that we've covered for next year, that's going to increase that number, right? We also did approve a 3 to 4% raise, right? So we know that payroll next year is going to be embedded in that number. So next year, I anticipate that 96.7 to be, you know, anywhere maybe 100 million, which would now change the required 75 days, right? So that could jump up to maybe 20, $21 million. So awesome. it's a formula. So just keep that in mind, yes, as I go through the process, right? David, go to the next page. So the impact on the fund balance. Yes, sir. So as I mentioned, we are right now at $40.9 million. But let's take into account these numbers here. I've already come to the board with a budget amendment number one, $1,800,000, right? That budget amendment number one was for items that were in fiscal year 2022, that at the end of the fiscal year, we didn't get to pay them out, but we know they're gonna get paid out this year. We also did the pay increase of $2.2 million. So we know that that's gonna come out of this year fund balance, right? As we mentioned, the security expenditures, that was at $2.6 million. The ESSER projects, if we decided to do them, was at $5.5 million. The emergency, unbudgeted items at $1.5 million. If we decided to do all the capital projects that we have listed there, $3.6 million. And then the one thing that Ski and I are looking at right now is our ADA possible shortfall. We budgeted based on 9,200 ADA. Our enrollment numbers have hit our mark. Normally, in a normal school year, what we did was we went back historically. Our district always operates at about 97% attendance. So even when we did this budget, we were a little conservative. We dropped that down. But what we're seeing right now is we're about at, what, 93%. And historically, our district, you know, regardless, we've always come back to about 96, 97. So because we're not there, we're projecting that this year's revenue will be short about $1.6 million. And so if you take all that into account, that drops, you know, that would drop our fund balance to $21.8 million if we did everything. So I know I've been asked before, what's your comfort number?
Yeah.
And I can tell you right now, my comfort number is not 21.8, because as I mentioned, I know next year when they recalculate the first, that will be cutting it very, very close. So if you go back to the presentation, I know Mark and I discussed, you know, rejecting the ESSER projects, right? So now you're looking at that balance, you know, bumping back up to about $26, $27 million.
What is your comfort number?
My comfort number. David, go back to the fund balance. Go back to the fund balance. Okay.
One more.
So just a little history here, right? A little history. So historically, prior to 2018, our district would carry a fund balance of about $25 million, right? I went back in a couple more years, right? But in 2017, we did the fiscal year change, which we knew was going to add to our fund balance. So that got us to $31 million. We knew when we did that, we were going to go out and try to take care of some projects. So we knew that that fund balance was going to come down. But 18-19, of course, we were hit with COVID. So you see some of the savings there, you see how we steadily increased to where we're at right now. But as I mentioned to Dr. V, because of how we need things in our district, you know, I told Dr. V my comfort number was 30. I mean, to be honest with you, I mean, I think that's what I mentioned even, you know, previously when I was asked, right? But again, will we be successful at 27-28? I think yes, it allows us a cushion there. But I personally, because I told Dr. Reed, I think I told Cabinet when we discussed it, I would be comfortable staying where we normally would have been prior to COVID, prior to illness, which is around the 28 million.
Okay.
That's again, if you're asking for my opinion.
It's inevitable that things are going to, emergencies pop up.
Yes.
Well,
yes, sir.
It's being more expensive now.
And so you see how quickly our fund balance drops.
Yeah.
And again, just remember, we did do that pay raise, so we don't know what the funding is going to be. That's a reoccurring cost next year.
Yes, sir.
You know, and so those are all things that I'm looking at. We've discussed at the cabinet level when we're looking at, okay, what's going to happen next year. You know, so those are all difficult questions.
So reject the $5.5 million.
That's for sure our recommendation, yes. Now, again, As we discussed the several different items, there's different things that we haven't approved yet, but that's the board to decide, are we going to proceed with those items? Are we not going to proceed with those items?
Personal approach. Yes.
We're in a legislative session. You haven't heard anything. I mean, I haven't read anything that projects what funding is going to be available to school, other than the fact that Texas got a ton of money.
That's exactly what we've heard. We've heard that they're looking at certain things, but and the unfortunate part, what I was saying, Dr. Vidaudi, is that we're going to go into approving this budget for this new year. I'll have to have it ready in May, and I will not have, I know I won't have the answer as to what they're going to do. So that in itself complicates things a little bit more because, again, you know, what does the board approve in May and June, not knowing yet what's going to happen as far as funding until July, maybe even August, as it always happens.
Well,
and that's going to be difficult.
Well, I think it's a safe assumption. It's not going to be less.
No.
Okay. So there's going to be something. We just don't know what the something is.
Yes, sir. That is correct.
Maybe that's for four, sir.
So did it go back down to the last slide? So that we can just look at it. So again, yes, Mr. Rivera, it is our recommendation that we don't approve the $5.5 million. But as Mark mentioned, at some point, to address some of the needs, we will have to come back to the board and request some of that money, right? Because again, we will need to address some of those problem areas, as Mark mentioned. We've talked about maybe $1 million, $2 million, just depending.
Like Band-Aid expense, essentially, right?
Yes, to get us
a little bit more than a Band-Aid, because we would keep what we do, right? So we wouldn't necessarily put something and then go rip it out when we bring equipment.
It's a component of the final product.
So we would get it, but instead of doing everything at one time, there's a couple of components, we'd say, let us go replace these components. They're going to stay. We're not going to rip these out. So when we come back and finish the rest of it, that's already there.
Oh, okay, so it's towards.
Yes.
Okay.
Is there anything here that's a longer-term project that you thought about financing through a maintenance tax note?
Well, there is a lot of items there, sir, that we could finance through a maintenance tax note. And I'm glad you asked that, because I did reach out to Esla Nojosa. I spoke with Bobby. He did send me a couple scenarios. I did ask him for at least three scenarios. He sent me some 15, most maintenance tax notes run 15 years. As a matter of fact, the last ones that we've done, the last two have gone 15 years. But what I did also, knowing some of these projects, you know, most of them are about a 10-year range. I did ask him to send me the same scenarios with a 10-year loan. So I did ask him for a $3.5 million maintenance tax note, what that would cost. And at the interest rate that they're projecting is 4.10. Which is still a good interest rate for our district, because of our good ratings and our fund balance. That payment there would come out to about $430,000 a year. And again, these are all scenarios that they ran that the district does have it within their capacity to go out and request. I did ask them for a $5 million maintenance tax note. That payment there would be $619,000 per year. And then lastly, I did ask for a $7.5 million, and that would be at $924,000 per year. I know Dr. Vidaudi asked me, what do we have on our books? We do have two maintenance tax notes. We have a maintenance tax note 2013 and a maintenance tax note 2018. And we still have 2013. The maturity on that one is 2028. So we're a few years away from that note expiring. And then the last maintenance tax note, 2018, that one expires in 2033.
But to look for buses, aren't they things of that nature that once paid off, we're probably gonna have to use it again?
Yes, sir. So if you recall the 2013 maintenance tax note, that's when we were gonna do the natatorium. And then we redirected that, we addressed a lot of these needs, similar needs that are on this list. With that, and then in 2018, the last time that we actually took care of bigger capital projects, that one was used to take care of the some items at athletics, some vehicles, and some remodeling that we did. That was the last one. Original note on that one, just to give you a little history, the 2013 note was $3.5 million, and the 2018 note was $1.8 million.
$3 million was for what?
Initially, that was going to be used for the natatorium.
Okay. When you use a maintenance tax note, it's the most expensive, even though it's a 4% rate, still the most expensive borrowing that a district can use, right? Nonetheless, it's still 4%. And I just wonder, you know, either a combination of fund balance and maintenance tax note, either to do the projects that are on the page right now or to do additional projects that you kind of wish were on the page and maybe on the cusp of thinking about.
Anything happening that now we don't have that.
And I don't know if the board was interested in knowing what that combination may look like. I don't know.
Yeah, I definitely think I would want to see some kind of a waterfall on that shows like a combination of the two, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There are some things that the generator that concern me, right? And then there's just some things that we need to do. 4%, it's not horrible.
So I was looking at the interest rates that we paid for the last two. We were at 3.1.
At 3.1.
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
so we're still exactly as I'm saying four, and if interest rates were to drop, you know, as always, you know, we can always try to.
Yeah, I'm not real familiar with them, so with the maintenance tax, so I'll have to research it. But what are the interest rates on the 13 and the 18? You said
so, 3.1? Yeah, so on the 13, it was 2.72.
2.1.
Yes, and on the 18, it was 3.1%.
So a question to the 5.5 and that being the ultimate get-it-all-done package for HVAC, right? Mm-hmm. You talked about band-aiding it or fixing it. Do you have a cost to that? Did you say it? Did I miss that?
Well, that's
the thing we look at. The same thing we say we'd like to maybe put $1 million, $1.2 million is the side. Take care what we need to, and then just in case anything else, right?
But those, given the climate, those are assets that we're hoping or that we're thinking are going to come back down to a normal price value. Right now, we're overpaying for all of
them. Yes, we're overpaying. I can assure you, we're overpaying for labor. We're overpaying for all these things that. We should see settling.
Right.
I don't know if we'll go back to original, we should definitely see settling. And I don't know if you've read, used car sales prices now are starting to drop.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you're overpaying for it and then you're paying interest over it, then now you're just adding to the cost of whatever it could be if it could drop.
Yes,
which,
sir.
I mean, I foresee that, if anything, HVAC's got to drop because they're not going to have extra money.
They're not going to, exactly. That's going to run out, and then now what everyone's going to do.
Right, and then, yeah, so you're going to be hustling to sell HVAC stuff,
yes,
right? Ideally,
yes.
I'm not an analyst, but that's what I would assume.
No, because you're right, because there is some type of finite, there's a finite amount of money that's out there.
Right, and then it's done.
And then it's done.
So for the maintenance tax, you know, the last one that you said was, what was the amount?
It was $1,850,000.
And over how many years?
It was 15 years now.
That's a 15-year.
But that was a 2018 tax note?
Yes.
No, but the option that you gave us, like you gave us three options.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Oh,
I'm sorry.
Three options that we have here.
Yes.
So the ones I read to you were 10 years because, again.
All 10 years.
Yeah, all 10 years because, again, when I was looking at some of the projects, we were looking at the lifespan of some of these items,
right?
Let's say, for instance, track. A track normally runs about 10 years, right?
Okay.
So I know we've heard the board before say, well, we don't want to finance something.
Overexceeded,
right? But when you start looking at pushing it to 15, And I had an interesting conversation with our bond counsel because they said even some of these items, you know, you can do it at 15. So in looking at the dollar amount for 15, again, looking at 3.5 million, that drops down to 315,000 per year.
The same interest rate?
Same interest rate, yes, sir. And then at a 5 million, it drops down to 449,000 the yearly payment. Yeah. And then the 7.5 million, 674,000.
So
yes.
7.5 was the max number that you gave us of money to go out, or the in
that's
the,
what, that's
the
what
scenarios
I mean.
That you have.
Yes, ma'am. That's what I requested. Again, it was just a quick conversation.
Right,
said,
but that was the largest.
That
yes.
was the largest.
I would be more interested in just a quick calculation in like what interest paid difference between 10 and 15 years. I mean, obviously, I don't think it is smart to finance an asset that's a 10-year, you know, for 15 years. But I just for numbers' sake, I'd be interested in that. So, because I don't really know, and then, you know, go back and look at, okay, so what are we going to finance with that tenure? And is anything a long-term capital asset or permanent, you know, building or something like that? That would, because then that would be worth a longer.
So the couple items that Mark and I talked about is, of course, the HVC projects. You know, those typically last for
10 years,
right?
10-year life.
David, if we go back to the capital projects schedule. So some of the things here that would qualify would be, I would say, the tennis court lighting, the dance studio would qualify, and I think the turf we've done it before. The special ed project up there would not qualify under maintenance sector because that is a new building.
So it's a building.
It's a new
building. So a maintenance act, but you can't do a permanent structure.
It would only address something that's already existing.
Got it.
Yes, ma'am. And again, we would confirm all this with Dr. Los Santos and his staff, but that's what we've been told before, yes.
And just to confirm, I mean, Anita said it, but, you know, just let's not extend ourselves beyond the estimated life of an asset.
Yes.
Right.
Like turf, I mean, we know it does less than 10 years. Right. I mean, facility to get 15, so. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I didn't realize you couldn't do permanent structure, but obviously maintenance tax, right?
Yes.
So things that you have to maintain.
Yes, so anything that's new, you could. Anything existing that you wind up putting into repair, yes, we could.
So 2.85 for sure on that list could come out of the maintenance.
Come maintenance tax, yeah. And so that kind of stays, you kind of stay with the money you have in there for emergencies.
Is he happy?
Oh, yeah. I sleep better.
I can say you take a personal approach. I like
yes.
that.
What was the payment on the
7.5
over
10?
$900,000.
Yes, 924,000.
924.
Yes. And if we go to a 15, it goes down.
And again, I think once they officially put that out, you know, it, historically sometimes they're conservative with that number. For the most part, they've always come back with a little bit better
interest
dollar
rate.
Amounts. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Historically, so.
So the district-wide $5 million boardroom, because it's a new structure, wouldn't qualify for a maintenance tax because you're not redoing.
That is correct. Yes, sir.
That was my last question. Was that district-wide boardroom? That's that second, basically, bond we went out for.
That is, yes, sir. That was included in that part. So that's an option.
Was it $9 million back then, or no?
No.
It was $3.5 million.
I think we're the $9 million we had talked about. Also, we renovating some other stuff in there.
Central office.
Yes. We talked just.
Oh, so this is not central office.
No. This is strictly a off-site boardroom.
So this is strictly
which is normally part of a central office, or like are that we would still need a whole.
Normally, districts have it within their central administration.
They'll have permanent flags.
But this would be a boardroom. And,
yes.
And then
we
talked about building it multi-purpose so we could do trainings and we could have bigger trainings and things like that. And so
yes.
that would help.
Where would we to place this boardroom?
We talked two spaces we talked about was behind, in between both buildings, kind of set back. There's some space in between both buildings.
Yeah, okay. Where all the trees are.
Yes, sir. That was one area. And if we took down the other one, well, we could possibly try to do something around there as well.
So this is a new question. I don't know, are there limits to, let's say at first we propose Pepe's idea about $100 million bond. That's one. Let's say that wasn't to go. And then you go to using this maintenance tax note. Was there a cap on the maintenance tax note? Does it make sense to build some of these things, whether it's the band hall or refurbish the band hall? I'm sorry, not build, refurbish the band hall, refurbish the cafeteria, the remodels that are needed. Like, is there a cap to that?
There is a cap, sir, to the what we can borrow, because again, they'll go based on capacity. So there's a formula that they'll run. But ideally, I think, for a band hall like this, so you're going to get more than 10 years use, right?
Yes.
And so normally, typically something like that, you use a bond. Because the tax, you know, the people that are going to utilize that building, you want the taxpayers to kind of pay for that over 30, 40 years or whatever, right? Because we're hoping that last that long.
So a couple of things as we've been talking about this, we've got short term, and we've got some long term goals that we really need to start thinking about. So I know we've had our two bonds that have failed, but if you look at this list, you know there's no way we can take care of what we're talking band hall. But we've got all these main classrooms that really need renovation.
Yes.
And so we've got a lot here at SHSS, and so the needs have not gone away. So long term, before, we kind of have to have that in mind so that we're not spending money on something that then we're going to come back and spend money again. And then it just looks like we put pieces of things together, and it doesn't look like a completed project. That would be my recommendation, that we really look at what is this district's long term? I mean, we plan in a year or two that we do want to try this out again, because there's no way. And And then you want things to look, like we talk about the boardroom. Well, you also want to make that look good from the street. I mean, you know, you don't want something that's just put in the middle and, okay, here we are. So, again, going out and looking at a vision long term, where do we think we're headed? And the other thing to keep in mind is where we sit right now. Kids are not coming. I mean, we're pushing. We're giving money for incentives. But COVID has changed. And kids get a sniffle and the parents keep them at home. And it doesn't matter how many times a principal calls. I mean, we're sitting at 93. This district has never, has never, ever been at 93. We're all completely shocked. Well, that's hitting our pocketbook as well. Mm-hmm. So, again, you know, we also need to look at long-term, and is there a question? No?
No.
Okay. So that would be my recommendation to the board, is that there's two things. One, our funding and what's coming in on the day-to-day and what our vision is for these bigger projects. And then what can we fiscally take care of right now, short-term, so that we're not putting money, pumping money somewhere that we're going to come back and repump money in again.
I agree.
And change.
If South Texas ISD, somehow their funding gets affected, who's a beneficiary of that reduction of their tax? Does it mean that our effective tax rate will be up, will allow us to get up a little higher, you think, or not?
Well, I guess it depends on what avenue they take, right? Do they go after the, what's their amount of tax? Or do they adjust their weighted their water, right?
Right.
Their water. Mm-hmm. So if they just adjust their water, I mean, it's just going to be an adjustment to them.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
if they adjust their taxes, you know, maybe that allows to tax more.
Right.
We don't know which route they're. Maybe they won't even change anything.
It's contingent to what they do.
What happens with them. Yes,
sir. Doesn't mean that we're going to get it that right now.
Okay.
The one thing we do know is I think I asked Richard Brzezinski to provide this, and I know that we do send about 200 of our students are at that district.
200?
So that's mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
a big chunk.
Does anyone have any questions regarding item 6B?
Mr. Russell, I believe the way we have it written down is, you know, we're asking for there to be action on those items. I don't know if we're, I know we talked about being a tax zone. I know we talked about, you know, combination. I don't know how we prepared.
But the capital improvement projects you're asking about, Jaime, are the ones only on the left or in Oval?
Are the ones that are listed on the agenda. We go back to the agenda. So these are the ones that we have listed. Everything else that we talked about, pretty much we've got the approval already. As you recall, the board did give Dr. Vidaudi authorization for security. So all those items have been already, they've already been encumbered, right? With the exception of the last item there, the elementary gates and the guard checks. That's $150,000 we have it listed on here because of the was it not here, Jason?
Yeah.
And I think, Coach, you had already mentioned that the terms and all that are posing liabilities and students are getting hurt and things like that, correct?
Mm-hmm.
For the turfs on the track on the high schools?
Okay, I've got a little bit of info if y'all want to hear.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so
absolutely.
Just synthetic turfs are, the lifespan is usually 8 to 10 years. We're going on year 10, we're going on year 8 over here. The warranty is usually 8 years before you start to see seams ripping apart. The weather has a lot to do with it.
Sure.
We did have a real bad storm a couple of summers ago that caused this turf, both of them really, but more so Thompson Stadium, to bubble up. And what that did is it pulled the turf on the sidelines. Field Turf, which is a company that installed it, came and they did their part over at Pioneer. That field was in bad shape as we speak. They were out of warranty. That's a Hellas product. They came in and they did the best job that they could, but when we're taking a look at the performance level of the kids that are on there, a new turf is going to increase that. It's also going to, when you take a look at it in terms of injuries, it should decrease. I'm not going to say that it's going to keep everybody safe, because a lot of times non-contact injuries occur. So it's definitely going to be a better product for the kids that are going to be on there. Who do those, what group of kids does it serve? When you take a look at a daily schedule, it's serving a lot of kids, and from football, soccer, track, band, dance, cheer. There's a lot of traffic on there. We don't have the luxury of having a district stadium like, for example, like Edinburgh. There's rarely any traffic on there because they usually reserve it for games, for events. When you take a look at things like in our, these companies, everybody improves. So what they do is they field dress it with what's called a climacool. And what that does is those little pebbles, those black pebbles, if you've ever been on there, they, a lot of times they stick on your socks and all. It's fabricated at lighter shade where it's deflecting the sun and the heat that is coming from it. But it also serves, like for example, baseball and softball. If we have bad weather in any of those fields, we're done with practice. We've got to go indoors, or it also allows those kids to have a practice facility as well. Our surrounding districts have turf. So if you're not practicing on turf, then we're at a disadvantage for those kids that are going to end up going and playing at McAllen. McAllen got new turf at both or all six of their softball and baseball fields. Mission's got it. We don't really have them in our district, but I think this could be a way to possibly get those STISD kids back if they see some of the facilities that we have, and we're staying up to par with our neighboring districts as well. So there's a lot of benefits, but I think the biggest one is just the safety issue that it brings.
I think so. Okay, thank you for that.
Number three on the dance room.
When we originally built Pioneer High School, there was not a dance room. It was promised as part of the upstairs above the band hall. It's an open area that's not finished out. So right now, our dance class, our bells team, and our folklorico don't have a dedicated space. They go between a classroom, the stage, and when there's something going on the stage, they're very much displaced. But here at SHS, they have three at the gym annex, that far room back there by SA3. They have three essential studios. And so, PHS.
But that would be the purpose of it, would be kind of like a studio that other
teachers, other classes. Yeah, try to rename that, to where flags can use it, band can use it with their small as well, multi-purpose.
Mm-hmm. So just like it's basically providing equity between the two schools for that kind of space.
Yeah, because you know, if you just call it dance room, then it's only going to be for dance.
Right.
Yeah. They should go along with, they do have more gym space there, so. They may not have the dance hall, but they have.
The flooring and then the gym space also is just the amount of planning and sharing. Who uses it in the morning? Who uses it during the day? Who uses it during after school? So even during the day, each period, the gym is being used by different sports. Yeah. And so then you also have another thing SHS has here is they use Castleman for certain sports. They use this so. It may seem like, well, they have five gyms, but then they're missing out on the equity. For once, the equity is in the opposite direction, the flow of.
I think the dance room or that portion of that building was the only thing missing to make both North and South high schools have the exact same facilities, I guess, if you will.
No, you got more building space over here.
We have two schools here.
Oh, square footage, yes, but as far as accessibility, like gym check, dance room check, dance room not check.
No. Yeah. So
it's a multi-purpose room.
Yeah, multi-purpose.
You got my blessing.
Yeah, they call it a studio. Yeah.
Mark, are those numbers pretty good, or were you thinking we're going to come back with a two times
table? No, I think we're pretty good with those numbers.
I'm fine if you overinflate them, actually, because I like
prefer.
We're going to push for savings.
Yeah. I think we're being very conservative.
Okay. Anybody have any other questions regarding item 6B?
I guess so. Your question is whether we're going to approve the entire list or not. Is that the question? Or maybe, if we want to get information on the capital tax bills, for now, just to move things along, the ones that I hear, because it's a safety issue, or is item 4, 5, and 7 are the ones that I see. Am I seeing that right? Yes. 4, 5, and 7 are the ones I think probably we could take action now if the board collectively chose. And at the next meeting, just bring this information, the meeting tax note. If we don't like it, we can move forward with the remaining items, if that's what we so choose. Or if nobody's interested in the maintenance tax notes, then it's all or nothing.
I'm interested in the maintenance tax notes, but maybe for some of those additional projects.
Yeah, so we can mix it.
So I'd like to make a motion to approve as been recommended by administration. That's my motion.
Okay, so I have a motion on the floor by Mr. Pepe Garcia.
And that's to approve this, the recommendations as is?
Yes, Ali.
It's a general fund. Is it coming from a general fund, right?
Yes, it's already been included in his projection for where we'll end up at the end of the year.
So we added the generator from the original list.
Which we should still have like a $7-8 million cushion on that.
Sure.
Okay, I second.
I have a motion by Pepe Garcia, second by Melissa Ramirez. Does anyone else have any further discussion or questions regarding this item?
So using a maintenance tax note for PHS turf to replace track and SHS turf replace doesn't make sense?
No, I'm not saying that at all. You're asking me.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that if we have if we could cover these projects and still be about $8 million above where they require us to be, then I would like to, you know, I personally would like to do whatever we can to show the public, hey, we're doing what we can.
Yeah.
But all those other projects that were on the right side of that list, like the cafeteria, the
gym
repairs,
upgrades.
The gym repairs, the, you know, those things I'm all for tackling those to get a tax note.
Yeah, I'd like to.
But I would like to get some action going, you know, me personally, you know, to show that we're trying to upgrade our facilities and.
Like for the maintenance tax note, do you think the gym upgrades is something that would fall under that? Just because, I mean, that looks like that's all 8 elementaries, right? Like, talk about using taxpayer money wisely and there being equity for the spending. I mean, that right there comes out to me as like, hey, this is going to touch all 8 elementary schools.
Okay, do I have all those in favor? Signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, same sign. Motion 6B passes 6-0. All right. All right, man, I saw you break a little sweat there.
Well, I know like the ESSER projects will eventually kick in.
Yes, it's inevitable, and I think we're all moving forward, we're all on the same page, we're all understand that we're basically making that move to take care of our cushion, and,
yes, sir.
But it is inevitable that stuff's going to start breaking,
yes, sir.
But we'll replace it, and not just replace it, but that would be part of the overall future component.
Yes.
Coach, we haven't put the other turfs that you were requesting, we're talking about on the right side, that's not in the right column, but we don't have pricing for that, or
it's
just not?
Are they No,
the other turfs, the ones he was talking
baseball,
about.
Baseball,
softball.
Oh, we haven't talked about it.
We haven't even looked at that. Okay. No. Just curiosity.
But the need right now, Coach, is definitely
for
safety.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
That'll bring us to item 6C, discussion and consideration to approve to award or reject competitive seal proposal 2223-11. Sherryland High School cafeteria and gym building and track upgrades.
Yes, sir. As discussed at the previous meeting, we are requesting to reject this bid.
So moved.
Second. I got a motion by Ricky Longoria, second by Pepe Garcia. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 6-0. Item 6D, discussion and consideration to approve to award or reject competitive seal proposal 2223-16, Sherryland High School SA3 building HVAC upgrades.
Yes, and once again, as discussed previous agenda, we are requesting to reject this bid.
So moved.
Second. Ricky Longoria made the motion, second by Pepe Garcia. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 6-0. The time is now 6:49 p.m. We'll take a short recess and then proceed to closed session.
Make a motion to go into closed meeting.
I have a motion by Pepe Garcia.
Second.
Second by Alejandro Rodriguez. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, the time is 7:38. We are back from closed session, back in open session.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion. An item 7A, personal matters. I move to approve the contract resignations as recommended.
I have a motion by Mr. Pepe Garcia.
Second.
A second by Alejandro Rodriguez. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 6-0.
On item number 2, Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion to approve the employment of personnel as discussed in closed session, subject to a satisfactory criminal background check, reference verification, and meeting all certification and employment eligibility requirements.
I have a motion by Mr. Pepe Garcia.
Second
by Alejandro Rodriguez. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion passes 6-0.
Mr. President, I'd like to make a motion for item D, 7D. I'd like to make a motion to approve the settlement of the lawsuit and payment of the deductible to our insurance carrier.
They got a motion by Mr. Pepe Garcia.
Second
by Mr. David Keith. Any further discussion on the matter? All those in favor of the item signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 6-0. Do I have a motion to adjourn at 7:39 p.m.?
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Pepe Garcia.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rodriguez. Any further discussion before we conclude the meeting? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 6-0.